Welcome back. This year, the Scottish novelist and poet Alexander Trocchi would have been 70 years old. On his death in 1984, he left behind a body of work, the notoriety of which has only recently been superseded by acknowledgement of its true literary value. Trocchi's own notoriety as drug user, womaniser and iconoclast has overshadowed a man of great enthusiasm for harnessing the power of the creative mind and challenging the accepted bounds of writing. Young Adam, set on the Forth and Clyde Canal, brought French existentialism to English writing. And Kane's book, a frank and graphic account of a drug user, ranks alongside the best works of his contemporaries, Allen Ginsberg and William Burroughs.
At certain moments, I find myself looking on my whole life as leading up to the present moment, the present being all I have to affirm. It is somehow undignified to speak of the past or to think about the future. I don't seriously occupy myself with the question in the here and now, lying on my bunk and under the influence of heroin, inviolable. One is no longer grotesquely involved in the becoming. One simply is.
Alexander Trocchi was born in Glasgow in 1925. But he always wanted to be elsewhere, I think. He saw himself as a somewhat extraordinary person in an ordinary situation. His father was a musician and band leader, but due to the changing fashions in music and the onset of arthritis, was unable to keep that up as a career, and subsequently became a music salesman. So there was always a struggle to get by. But his mother began to run a lodging house and take in paying guests, which of course was not entirely respectable in Trocchi's eyes. He saw it as unfortunate that the family had to lapse to that sort of extent.
Today, Kelly House is no longer a celebrated private mansion. In September 1939, when the government decided to evacuate school children from the big cities, the local education authority turned it into a co-educational boarding school for 200 Glasgow secondary school children.
Alex ended up in Kelly House. There were 9 schools there altogether, so it was a very exciting place to be for a young teenager. There was a mock election and some very serious speeches being made by some of the candidates for parties. But Alex had other ideas, and he suddenly emerged from behind a bush with some pals dressed in tinfoil and tinsel as the Martian Party and hijacked the voters and consequently won by a landslide. So he found that extraterrestrial life was somewhat more conducive to him than ordinary politics. And he definitely had aspirations to be an outsider and someone extraordinary at that time. He applied to the RAF after initially being a pacifist because a girl that he fancied at the Kelly House, Betty White, had said quite casually that she would only marry a pilot. So he immediately decided he wasn't a pacifist, he was going to join the RAF. And he got into the RAF in 1943 and did part of his training in Canada. Unfortunately, his urge to play pranks continued with him there, and he was actually suspended and sent back in ignominy after bombing his airbase with toilet rolls, which nearly caused an international incident. So he was offered the choice of being demobbed or joining the Navy, and surprisingly he took the latter and went on Arctic convoys in HMS Campbelltown, escorting ships to Murmansk and the Arctic Circle, which stayed in his mind for a long time. The cold Arctic conditions and the sheer boredom of the exercise. But he was demobbed in 1946 and he went to university then.
I first came across Alexander Trocchi when I was just joining the staff in English department in 1947. I think we all thought he was a very brilliant kind of student. He was doing honours in English and philosophy, and it was assumed that he would get a first. He didn't in the end, he got a second. And we were all very disappointed at that. He was doing other things. He was very erratic. When he wanted to work, he would work very hard. When he didn't want to work, he'd be working on his pig farm 10 miles from Glasgow. He thought he'd live with his girlfriend in a cottage and do pig farming. And you can't do that and get a good honours degree at the same time. It's just not possible.
Because his tutors regarded him as a first-class student, he was awarded a travelling scholarship of £400 to allow him to travel with his wife around Europe, which he was very keen to do. And so he didn't actually wait for the graduation ceremony itself, but set off for Paris and in fact the Middle East as fast as he could.
I thought it was really pretty amazing the way in which he really very, very quickly got in touch with the intellectual elite of Paris, and before anyone knew what was happening, he was getting them all to contribute to his magazine. He got Sartre, he got UNESCO, Genet, and they were all writing for him. He had a very strange ability to get in touch with people and win them over. He had a strange kind of charm. It was a sort of dangerous, sinister charm in a way, but he was extraordinarily good at quickly getting people onto his side to do things for him.
Paris was a place of experimentation. He experimented in every possible way he could, sexually, pharmaceutically, whatever. His marriage fell apart under the pressure of these experimentations, but he certainly had tried heroin and other drugs in Paris. But at the same time, he was writing, and he was immersed in the literary world there, which was very exciting, and had become an existentialist, and was already the author of several novels. Alex was always a very serious writer and wanted to do serious things in the world of literature. But at the same time, he had to make a living, and so that's why he wrote novels, which he described as light novels, but in fact erotic novels for the Olympia Press. Alex was largely known in Paris as the editor of the Merlin magazine, which was an international review publishing some of the best names of the time. He also was an associate of Samuel Beckett and published some of Henry Miller's work. Merlin was a very important and significant magazine in post-war France.
The actual editorials that Trocchi wrote for the magazine were interesting. They were worth reading. He had partly the job, I suppose, of trying to get people in the island fastness of Britain to realise that things were actually happening on the continent. You know, he wanted to make them aware that really the literary scene in Paris was very, very interesting at that time, and it did have an effect, I think.
In 1955, Trocchi left both his wife and children and the Paris literary scene behind. After a short stay in England, he moved to New York, hoping for greater recognition.
Many of the writers in Paris had actually returned to America by that time. He found that he was a fairly well-known face, and soon got into literary crowd there, people such as Norman Mailer, and through them he rapidly became a name on the circuit. He had taken with him in a suitcase to New York large amount of notes which were to form the basis of his best novel, Kane's Book. While he was in New York, to keep his body and soul together and to get money to buy drugs, he got a job on the scows. Now, the scows were barges on the Hudson River. It suited him perfectly. He had a little room in the scow and his typewriter, and he just, from his position on the barge, he could see Manhattan at night, all the lights, and he was a real outsider at last, which is where he'd always wanted to be. And he set about turning Kane's Book into a masterpiece.
During his time in America, Trocchi met and married Lynn Hicks, who spent an extended stay with him among the West Coast beat community. Their return to New York led to disaster, as Trocchi's drug affairs resulted in his fleeing to Britain under threat of the death penalty for trafficking.
Although there were hints of his notoriety and his fame in America, he wasn't really widely known until 1963, when Young Adam first came out. Young Adam is an existentialist thriller. On the surface, it's the story of a woman whose body is found in the Clyde by two men working on a barge. It then transpires that one of the men on the barge was actually the lover of this woman, and it goes on then to eventually deliver an attack on the capital justice system that was then in Britain.
Now, it is boring when you get used to it, to crawl along a canal, to wait for a lock to open, for water to level. But you see some interesting things too, like the cyclists on the footpaths where a canal runs through a town, and kids playing and courting couples. You see a lot of them, especially after dusk and in the quiet places. They're in the quiet places where there's no footpath and where they've had to climb a fence to get to. Perhaps it's the water that attracts them as much as the seclusion, and of course, the danger.
During a writers' conference at the 1962 Edinburgh Festival, Trocchi set himself against the Scottish literary establishment with an outspoken attack on its figurehead, Hugh McDermid.
Although McDermid had started off as being an internationalist in his young years, now he was associated more with something very Scottish. And Trocchi, although he was Scottish and Glaswegian, was trying to say, well, it's high time you again looked outwards and were aware of what was happening in the world outside. And he was putting that forward as a new kind of literature. Things were happening in France, in America, in other countries, of which Trocchi was well aware, and of which he thought McDermid was not really aware of. And he thought it was time to say some hard things to McDermid in public.
In 1964, Trocchi's ideas crystallised into the Sigma Project. He set about the recruitment of a million minds, willing to break down the boundaries of the separate arts and turn their energies to the creation of a new world.
At the present time, in what is often thought of as the age of the mass, We tend to fall into the habit of regarding history and evolution as something which goes relentlessly on, quite out with our control. The individual has a profound sense of his own impotence as he realizes the immensity of the forces involved. We, the creative ones everywhere, must discard this paralytic posture and seize control of the human process by assuming control of ourselves. We must reject the conventional fiction of unchanging human nature. There is, in fact, no such permanence anywhere. There is only becoming.
The idea of it was that writers, artists, filmmakers, and all sorts of different people with a creative attitude could recognize one another, and that if they combined, they could change things. And it was an idea to have a consciousness revolution, a revolution in inner space. Where Trotsky sees the viaducts and bridges, he said, we must seize the means of communication. I think, on one hand, though, his creativity extended beyond the book and beyond conventional ideas of art. So he was very involved in happenings, and he did sculpture too. He was also a kind of social mechanic. So I never go along a line which says, oh, Alex Trocchi didn't fulfill himself as a writer.
When I write, I have trouble with my tenses. Where I was tomorrow is where I am today, where I would be yesterday. I have a horror of committing fraud. It is all very difficult, the past even more than the future, for the latter is at least probable, calculable, while the former is beyond the range of experiment. As the ghosts rise upwards over the grave wall, I re-coffin them neatly and bury them. It is, I suppose, my last will and testament, although insofar as I have a choice in the matter, I shall not be dying for a long time.
His later years in London, the last 2 decades, in fact, of his life, really, from late 1960 till 1984 when he died, he wasn't writing very much at all, and he admitted this and he felt very bad about it. It was a kind of long writer's block, and he must have felt that he probably had written himself out. The things he wrote were so much a part of that time in the 1950s, 1960s, that maybe he had nothing to say in the 70s and 80s. If he had been able to find some other subject, he could write with power. He could write very well.
He was more than just a regional writer. He was someone who had seen a lot of the world, and whose work reflects that. He was a very keen mind, and he could see clearly through all the dross and cut through to the, you know, basic meanings of life itself. Everybody who has read his work feels very closely identified with it, with the search for identity that's in it, the pursuit of truth. I mean, it really is first-class writing.
Alexander Trocchi died of pneumonia in April 1984. His last years had been marked by tragedy. In the 1970s, both his wife Lynn and his eldest son Mark had died. Struggling with writer's block, he found some success as a book dealer and a new partner in Sally Child, a young fashion designer. His influence had waned, but would not be forgotten by his 60s fellows.
His writing at its best is great. And I mean, Samuel Beckett acknowledged that and put a blurb on Kane's book saying it was of the highest excellence. I think he was a very wonderful writer. Often his writing was marred in different ways, and the strange route that his life followed didn't result in a great large body of work, but everything that he ever wrote had punch and had attack, and the things that he was exploring now, people see how relevant they are. That he was there first and he articulated so much about it was very valuable.